computer system. Originally, I figured that at the end of part two, I'd hook up the box and be done with the build, and nothing out of the ordinary would happen. Boy, was I wrong. I encountered almost every issue possible, probably as punishment for rushing the build a little bit. During this video, I will walk through how to deal with power on self-test and blue screen of death issues such as the ones I encountered. When I first plugged everything in, I crossed my fingers and hit the power button. And nothing happened. So much for crossing my fingers. The fan spun and the motherboard lit up, but nothing appeared on the monitor. The initial load screen of a computer system is part of what is known as the power on self-test, or POST for short. When the POST screen doesn't show up, that means something has gone horribly, horribly wrong somewhere with the hardware. Computer systems used to come with a piezo speaker that the motherboard would send beep codes to that the owner could look up in the motherboard manual. It's more difficult, but not impossible, to diagnose issues without a piezo speaker, and I was too lazy to scrounge one up from an older system. The first thing that I checked was to make sure that all necessary power connectors were attached to the motherboard. The number one thing that system builders overlook is attaching the CPU power connector, which can be difficult to access. Unlike me, as evidenced in the previous video, intelligent system builders connect the CPU power cable to the motherboard before attaching the motherboard to the case. So my first step was to double check and make sure that sucker was firmly attached. The other reason I first focused on power was because of an odd power input for three or more graphics cards on my motherboard that I had noticed before, so I spent some time researching to make sure that I didn't actually need it. To keep this story short, I didn't. The Tom's Hardware website has an excellent guide related to diagnosing POST issues. I recommend following this guide if you ever run into POST issues yourself. However, the instructions in the guide didn't appear to help me, so I tore down the build to the bare minimum. I ended up removing the graphics card, disconnecting the data and power cables to all of the hard drives and Blu-ray drive, and even removed all of the RAM. Without RAM, I knew it definitely wouldn't POST, so I added just two sticks of RAM back into the system and verified that each one was seated correctly with the help of a flashlight and a lot of analysis. At this point, the computer POSTed fine. I powered it off and added the two remaining sticks of RAM to the two remaining slots and started it back up, but it didn't POST. Removing all of the RAM again and putting in just the other two sticks of RAM also POSTed fine. This led me to think that two of the RAM sockets were not functional. But it turned out after adding the other two sticks of RAM and pushing down on them that one of the sticks wasn't fully in place, even though it looked like it was properly seated. At this point, the computer POSTed fine multiple times in a row. It's always a good idea after a recovery like this to POST several more times just in case any given POST is a fluke. After I was satisfied that the core components were functional, I started adding the other components back in, one at a time, and posting each time. During the graphics card installation, I discovered through more trial and error that one of the DisplayPort monitor cables wasn't plugged all the way into one of my monitors, even though it sounded like it had clicked into place. However, this wasn't the end of my troubles. Out of laziness, I had up and moved my hard drives directly into this new machine from my old one. This is always a bad idea, but I understood the risks that the system might not boot or have driver conflict issues. Once I had booted up the OS, I installed all of the latest motherboard drivers from the motherboard manufacturer's website. Everything seemed to be working fine, and even Device Manager reported no unknown hardware. I like to stress test new hardware to discover problems, and I prefer to use benchmarking software as my first test. So I fired up a free piece of software called 3DMark and let it run. 3DMark ran just fine. At this point, I thought I was about 95% in the clear. However, I didn't have any time to do the remaining tests, so I let the build rest. A few days passed and I began the remaining test. Counter-Strike Global Offensive. is one of the most stable, modern, and nearly bug-free video games out there. The test in this case was to see how a real-world video game would fare on the new hardware. Unlike benchmarks, video games simultaneously push all aspects of the hardware to its limit. Before beginning to write software on any given piece of hardware, I found that it is important to make sure that the hardware itself is rock solid. The goal of playing the game was to expose any remaining hidden hardware problems. In this case, I was able to play through about 1.5 rounds before the machine would suddenly display the infamous blue screen of death, also known as a BSOD, with a random error message. This sort of problem is generally an indicator of something fundamentally wrong with a driver, the RAM, or another piece of hardware in that order. So I started updating the NVIDIA driver to the latest version was a nightmare that I won't go into. However, after updating the driver, I still ran into BSODs with running Counter-Strike. The next thing I ran was a program from the command prompt that would restore corrupted system files. During the scan, the system threw up another BSOD. At this point, I was severely disturbed about my brand new system stability, or rather, the lack thereof. The next stop was RAM. I originally had problems with getting it seated properly, so I figured it might be possible that one of the sticks was bad or had other issues, possibly power related. Since power is more important, I first moved the CPU fan header to CPU fan 2 since CPU fan 1 sat right next to the RAM sockets. But nothing changed regarding the blue screen of death issue. Then I burned a tool called memtest86 to a CD, rebooted the machine, and booted off the bootable CD into this tool. I then let memtest86 run overnight. All of the tests passed without any issues. On the plus side, the tests ruled out RAM as the source of the problem. After all of this, I was left with a few possibilities. Outdated firmware that conflicted with the latest motherboard drivers, an overheating component, a bad OS install due to transplanting the OS hard drive and not reinstalling the OS, or dead on arrival hardware, in that order. I then went back to the motherboard manufacturer's website where I saw a possible BIOS firmware update. Updating the firmware on a motherboard is not a task to take lightly. In my case, my motherboard has two removable BIOS chips and a jumper to switch between them. The second chip is a backup to reflash the primary in the event a BIOS flash fails on the primary. Flashing the BIOS usually has all sorts of hazard lights surrounding the process, and for good reason. If flashing a non-removable BIOS chip fails, and it can, the motherboard will be bricked. Dual BIOS setups are extremely useful for recovering from a failed flash. In fact, my initial flash of the BIOS actually failed, but it immediately failed and fortunately didn't do any harm. This just goes to show that flashing failures do happen. My second attempt successfully updated the firmware to 1.70. It turned out that 5 major updates to the firmware had been made since my motherboard was released, including several important microcode and Windows 10 updates. After the system booted up, I went and downloaded HW Monitor from CPU ID. I was still concerned about possible temperature issues with the system under load as a cause for BSODs. I then downloaded PC Mark and ran it while watching temperatures rise and fall during the benchmark. My main reason for benchmarking wasn't to measure performance, but rather to see if a BSOD would crop up again under non-gaming usage. Fortunately, it didn't. After that, I proceeded to play some more Counter-Strike Global Offensive. Not to see how much face I could wreck, but rather to test to see if a BSOD would show up again after a round or two. Fortunately, the system hasn't produced another BSOD, but I've only played a half dozen rounds. For the moment, I'm fairly certain that I've dealt with the various issues that cropped up with this build. Had the BSOD shown up again, I would have reinstalled the OS from the ground up to eliminate any remaining driver conflict issues. If it had continued after that, I would have asked on various system builder forums, such as Tom's Hardware, what they thought. Only after exhausting all of my options would I have begun the process to RMA any components that I suspected as being faulty. This concludes the exciting third part of this build, and hopefully that's the last time I see a BSOD on this hardware. I hope that this was informative on how to diagnose build issues. Please leave kind comments below in the comments section, and thank you for watching.